we've learned a lot from that experience. So I'm going to give you a little bit of the story of how that nuclear explosion came to occur. And then talk about some of the things we're looking at to make absolutely certain it can never happen again. It'll be interesting to see the comparisons between risk management in a bank and risk management in a kind of laboratory science facility, because you may listen to me and conclude, well, we are light years ahead of your risk management techniques in banking. That could be an outcome. Another outcome could be, well, we all deal with the same kind of situations, and perhaps there's potential for sharing what we know and understand. So, first of all, I want to start by asking you to imagine that you've got 10,000 euros sat on a bank account doing nothing. And I'm going to try and tempt you into making an investment. So I'm going to show you this company. I've got results over a 7-year period. This is a completely fictitious example, so don't go thinking that this is a real organization. We've got revenues on an upward trend. We've got profits on an upward trend. Now you would look at that and say, that looks a pretty good investment. Okay, would you agree? Very successful, healthy looking company. But supposing I now add this line. This line plots the amount of risk this institution accepted in order to generate this profit. Now it doesn't look so good. The scary thing is that no institution, no company, no organization on this planet is able to reduce this line. There are a couple of reasons for that. First is accounting. Accounting principles, international financial reporting standards, generally accepted accounting principles, have a concept of fair value. Fair value says, what is the financial condition of this organization today and looking back in the past? So you will hear about the balance sheet as of a date, or the profit on loss account for the period ended. So it looks into the past. Accounting doesn't consider the likely consequences of risks we have today and the likely consequences of those risks. We have here a kind of subprime banking condition from 2007 and 8, where banks have clearly accepted risks but went way beyond their accumulated profits. Disaster, nuclear explosion, catastrophic, okay? Wiped out banks serially. Even though these banks had invested massively in their risk management and risk mitigation techniques. So something's going horribly wrong with accounting and risk management. And that's where we started to look at this. Now there are some real life victims, if you like, of this circumstance. One is my claim to fame is 25 years at JP Morgan Chase on the Chase Manhattan side. This is my former chief executive, Jamie Dimon, chief executive officer and chairman of the JP Morgan Chase & Co. He received a phone call back in 2012 saying that the Wall Street Journal and Bloomberg were about to run a story on something they called the London Whale. Clearly the journalists were picking up intelligence information about something that JP Morgan Chase was engaged in, which was generating significant market impacts and significant likely losses. The reaction is that they were giving, if you like, the right of reply to JP Morgan Chase before they ran these stories. So we're talking about the chairman, the chief executive officer of this biggest bank in the United States. He called all the people together and said, I need to know exactly what the situation is regarding what they're calling the London Whale. And the position that was given to him was, The position is balanced. There is no risk. That's the position that he was given. So he went public and made this statement. He said, this is all a tempest in a teapot, was the public statement he made. Months later, he was staring at $6 billion of loss. Okay? So his statement was, Diamond apologized for his earlier description of the losses as a tempest in a teapot, saying I was dead wrong, but maintained that he was misinformed about the scale of losses at the time. Okay? Now you've got to stop and think about that. That it wasn't a case of a rogue trader sitting at a trading desk doing crazy stuff that nobody knew about. This was the chief executive officer demanding from his organization precise, accurate, complete information about risk, and he was given the wrong answer, wrong by $6 billion. Okay? Now, I don't know about your industry, but certainly in my industry, we are led by what I would call a complete fallacy. Now, I'm taking a dangerous position here because I am disagreeing with the Chief Economic Advisor of the Reserve Bank of Australia and the Chief Economist of the Bank of England. Significant people. These are very influential people. And they produced a paper, and I came across this statement, which quite honestly horrified me. The statement was, a risk is inherently unobservable, only outcomes are observable. I don't know if you agree with that statement. The metric we tend to use for risk is red, amber, green. That is the common metric that we use. I don't know if you use the same metric, but we do. So a risk can either be red, amber, or green. My interpretation is that I kind of symbolized risk as a bomb. We're observing this bomb. And we can only, what this says is that we can only really know what this risk represents after it's exploded. Okay? That is a totally unacceptable position to take. I find it amazing that senior officials from our central banks can latch on to a statement like this, that risk is unobservable. How can we ever manage risk if we take the view that risk is unobservable? You know the mantra about you can't manage what you don't measure. Well, this is one step worse than that, because then you can't even observe it, let alone measure it. So we've got some issues to work on here. Again, I come back to the point I made earlier, that it's difficult for me to associate the condition in banking with your condition. You have to look at this and see if you recognize some similarities here or not. Pressing on. If we look at a landmark paper, the result of several years of intense research by an organization called COSO, this was a paper on enterprise risk management. Now I assume this is not banking specific, this is industry generic. So I would assume that this paper should have relevance for you. And again, the language is rather revealing because they have this thing is 202 pages long. Okay, so there's a lot of stuff in here. But I kind of come to this particular piece of it, which is kind of the core of it. I actually did a word search on this expression portfolio review, and I think that expression comes up in this paper about 50 times. Okay, so there's very definitely this focus on something that they call a portfolio view of risk. What does that mean? So let's start. I mean, first of all, it says an organization identifies and assesses, not measure, not quantify, assesses. Red, amber, green, high, medium, low, strong, medium, weak, on a scale of 1 to 10, but no amount, no quantification. Okay? So we have a method that revolves around assessment. So we've got assess, assess. It then says prioritizes. If your risk metric is a column, you tell me how you can prioritize risk if you have metric as a color. I think that a prioritization means comparison, and you can only compare values. It must be value driven for you to be able to prioritize it, because if you rank things, you must be able to rank them by something numeric, which you can't do if your risk metric is assessment-based. We need a measurement-based risk metric, an assessment-based metric. We can't do this prioritization and comparing something with risk appetite. Okay? Okay, then we say develops a portfolio view. And interestingly, it says portfolio view of the amount of risk. Amount implies quantity, right? Implies a measurement. But the strange thing is, they introduce a portfolio view and the word amount, but the whole paper is around assessment. So the assumption is that if we can figure out how to calculate the amount of risk, we can then start looking at a portfolio view. And a portfolio view, to me, to my mind, means the ability to quantify, to rank, compare, benchmark, prioritize, all those things that we can do in finance, because we have a value attached to finance. If we can attach a value to a risk, we can have the same kind of dashboards, techniques, management methods. So we want to target this portfolio view. But trust me, in the 202 pages of this document, it doesn't tell you how to do it. The document assumes that we have methodologies revolving around assessment, not measurement. So the project I'm leading at Durham University, with a lot of colleagues from other places, is can we quantify an exposure to risk? Could we quantify exposure to risk in a bank and compare those outputs to a facility like yours and have meaningful results? In other words, can we define a common metric for risk? And if we can, how do we calculate it? The first thing is that if you want a measurement system, you need a standardized measurement metric. Risk management doesn't have one. In banking, currency as a standard metric for risk doesn't work for lots of reasons. Currencies fluctuate. We compare currencies. Currency is not a stable measurement metric. We can influence monetary values. We want a metric that relates to risk directly and specifically. We didn't have one, so we'll create one. We'll just say, here's a new metric, and give it a name. So we created a metric called the risk unit, or RU. So if this works, I could say that one of your projects has this amount of risk in RUs, and the effectiveness of the mitigation of that risk is what we call a risk mitigation index, and what is left is the residual risk, the risk that you haven't effectively managed. This is summarized in this diagram. So these are the metrics that we want to generate. How much risk in the aggregate has been created, and we call that the inherent risk, RUs, which is representative of the maximum possible loss. So we'd have to take the view of one of your projects, we've created an artificial scenario, and say, what if this project stopped? What are the financial consequences of that event? how effectively have risks been managed and mitigated? And here we calculate a so-called risk mitigation index, which is a measure of risk mitigation effectiveness, and that's on a basis of 0 to 100. So if your risk management systems are absolutely perfect, you have a risk mitigation index of 100. If your risk mitigation systems are totally ineffective, you have a risk mitigation index of 0. We apply that to that to calculate the residual risk in our use. So how much risk remains that has not been managed and mitigated effectively? The residual risk in our use is the probability of loss. If we can do that, we can start looking at risks right across an enterprise, and most importantly, we can aggregate them, because the RU is an additive metric. A color isn't. We can't add red, ambers, and greens together. We just get a splotch of some weird color. With a numeric value applied to risk, we can aggregate, we can compare, we can rank, we can prioritize. We can set a limit and say, we can set standards and limits, and we can operate in according to that limit. You all understand budgets. So if I, as your chief financial officer, say your budget is X, not to see that budget, as a risk manager I can say, your risk limit is so many RUs, you're not allowed to exceed that limit in RUs. So that's the framework that we're working to. This work started back in about 2000. We started looking at this kind of methodology in JP Morgan Chase, and it was rolled out in all our principal operation centers, and we've been developing it since then. It would be very difficult for me in 10 or so minutes I've got left to give you a detailed explanation of how the method works. So I'm just going to give you a high-level overview, hopefully enough for you to understand how this all comes together. But we start by saying, what is the value of risk of whatever it is we're managing? And I've done my best. I'm the furthest thing from a scientist you can imagine. I'm an accountant banker. So I've done my best to think in perhaps the term that you would think in to try and associate our methodology with the world you move in. And I perfectly accept that I've probably not done a particularly good job of it. But what I would imagine is that you'd be looking at project costs to date, direct costs, allocated costs, capital expenditure, cost commitments, and then estimated liabilities on cancellation, penalties and fines, mitigation, compensation. Because a big driver of unexpected loss, the ultimate outcome of a risk, is unexpected loss. So if your project, for whatever reason, fails massively and gets cancelled, what is the value of risk? Okay, that's our starting point. I would assume that you've got accountants that are smart enough to come up with a figure. We then look at risk factors over which you have little or no control, which affect the inherent risk of your project. And we call those exposure uncertainty factors. So in your particular case, I would imagine that a risk factor is your sponsor, because you can't necessarily directly influence and manage your sponsor, but you are highly dependent on your sponsor doing certain things for your project to be successful. So I look at project sponsor, governance and accountability, requirements. We all know, I've certainly experienced the challenges involved in fluid requirements, quiet requirements that aren't totally nailed down. Funding, you've got enough money. 310 billion euros sounds like a lot of money, but is it enough? And the delivery schedule, is the delivery schedule realistic? So these are things that will affect, these are risk factors affecting your project, the inherent risk. You don't necessarily have direct influence over those factors. And we create tables with weighting factors based on expert criteria. We've done it for a bank, we assume we can do it for other institutions as well. Social impact and feasibility is another risk factor. If your project fails, you're going to be on the 10 o'clock news in the UK, you know, disaster in Romania, project failed with tremendous visibility, or is it something, if the event occurred, it wouldn't even ripple through the media at all? And the same political impact and visibility. Now what we would want to do is to sit down with your subject matter experts and flesh out these tables and the risk factors. We have developed an algorithm that will blend these elements to come up with the inherent risk. The inherent risk in our news. Okay? So that would be calculation. Now we have something we can compare. We can say that project is bigger than that project. We can have this calculation at subdivisions of a big project, so that we can look at each element and aggregate them up and compare. The next thing we do is look at your organization. So what we call business components. And I'm assuming that you've got project management, research units or laboratories, construction units, master data files, management units, cost systems management units, procurement units. We look at each component and we take the view that each component has some kind of risk mitigation impact. So whatever effects we have generated here, these units are there to make absolutely certain that this is successful, this doesn't generate an unexpected loss. So we capture basically your organization structure. Yeah. We then take a very simple view that if these units understand what their best practices are in terms of best practices which will mitigate or minimize any exposure here, if these best practices are implemented to an excellent or high standard, we would effectively have mitigated all of the risk that's created here. So what we've done is create a catalogue of what we call best practice scoring templates. And those best practices are weighted. So just as an example from my neck of woods, the best practice is business continuity. If we have a systems failure, and if you've got a current account with my bank, we have a systems failure, alternative processing sites will kick in, you will notice the difference. It may be in a panic, but you customers, you will notice the difference because we have business continuity plans in place. So we go to our business continuity experts and say, what are the best practices for an effective business continuity plan? They say, these are the best practices. Which are the best practices that have the most risk mitigation impact? We'll score those 100. And that could be the fact that you have a plan or not. If you don't have a plan, you can have business continuity. So score 0. Or it may be, do you do a notification test? A notification test is when a manager will send a message on a test basis to the people in the chain, and that message will be passed down as a test, and then reported back up to make certain that when you go through a crisis situation, your notification program will function effectively. So we have best practice scoring templates, and all these are weighted. And again, we use this data to generate algorithms to calculate the risk mitigation index, which is here, and then we can complete the calculation. So at a high level, that's what we have. We assume that some of these best practice templates that have been fully researched and tested would apply to your organization as well. So people, for example, three elements, competence, stress, and experience. Stress, for example, is overtime. So we have a computation that says how much overtime do you work. If your teams are working high degrees of overtime, their risk mitigation effectiveness is reduced because they're tired and exhausted. We assume that a template such as this is exportable right across all industries. We have, I happen to be in Romania because we're working with a Romanian software house to develop the prototype software. Mr. Paul Costa is here. I'd have to give you a lot of history to explain how Paul and I came into contact with each other, but Durham University is currently working with Paul's firm Synoptics, and if anyone is interested in seeing what that list looks like, then here's Paul's contact details. I'm sure he'd be delighted to. One other, I think, very important, and I don't think we have any auditors here, but if you do have an auditor, I'm sure I've been an auditor, I'm sure you equate to what it is like to audit an assessment, because it's your opinion against theirs. If we have a measurement metric, you can audit it. You can have a conclusion in financial audits. Auditors will propose adjustments to the financial statements because they say, our audit came to a different conclusion, the adjustment is this. With risk, if we use this method, we can have the same principle that an auditor can look at the way line management has rated their projects, and the auditor can come to a different conclusion and either downgrade the risk mitigation index or even upgrade the risk mitigation index, which makes auditing a lot more effective than taking a second guess on an assessment basis. That's a bit tongue-in-cheek.
Question: do you consider a risk assessment only the consequences, not only the consequences, not probabilities or comparators, not?
Basically, the methodology that we use, a proxy for probability, is what we call the residual risk. So we start with the occurring risk, which is the maximum possible loss in risk units, in our metric, our views. We then calculate the risk mitigation index, so how effective is this organisation in mitigating that risk. We apply that against the inherent risk to get the residual risk in our views, and the residual risk in our views equates to probability. But it's more, if I could just make a distinction here, between accounting thinking and risk thinking. Risk managers think in terms of probability. Accountants think in terms of categorization. So if I'm an accountant, I take every transaction that is entered into by this institution, and with each transaction, now accountants are expert in assigning an accounting value, the value used for accounting. What we're saying is, let's assign a risk value to transactions. Then we've got a complete view of risks triggered. So you've got to look at this distinction.
Yes, an interesting approach, and then we could think I put some points in my presentation to make